Ascend Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents HBR Guide to Leading Teams by Mary Shapiro, narrated by Jonathan Yen. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material.
What You'll Learn. How often have you sat in team meetings, grousing to yourself, "What a colossal waste of time. Why does it take forever for us to make a simple decision? What are we even trying to achieve here?" Dysfunctional teams are maddening, and sadly, they seem to be endemic to organizational life. But as the team leader, you have the power to change things for the better. It's up to you to get people to work well together and produce results. How do you avoid the pitfalls you've experienced so painfully in the past? This guide offers step-by-step advice, drawing on time-tested principles, practical exercises, guidelines for structured team conversations, and examples from a range of industries and organizational settings. You'll get better at picking the right team members, cultivating their skills, setting clear, smart goals, rallying support both within and outside the team, fostering camaraderie and cooperation, addressing bad behavior before it gets out of hand, promoting healthy dissent, resolving conflict when it rears its head, holding members accountable to one another, not just to you, keeping them focused and motivated to the end, identifying best practices for your next team. Introduction. Whether you're taking over an existing team, launching a new one, or have been leading a group for a while, getting people to work together to produce excellent outcomes is not easy. Each team is different, and each poses a distinct set of challenges. Maybe you've just been assigned to chair a task force of people from different units to launch a company-wide initiative. Perhaps you manage 5 people who have to work together daily as part of ongoing operations. Or maybe you've been struggling at the helm of a team so mired in conflict that the members couldn't reach agreement on anything if their lives depended on it. No matter what type of team you're leading, you probably face tight deadlines and high expectations, and feel the pressure to churn out project plans, assign tasks, and above all, execute. It's only natural. We create teams to accomplish work, after all, so we tend to focus mainly on tasks. But that's just one side of the equation. We also need to focus on the people who will be carrying out those tasks. If your team members don't have good relationships with one another, your team won't do good work. People will squabble. They won't trust each other. They'll feel underappreciated, grumbling that others aren't carrying their share of the load. They'll stop collaborating. Tempers will flare, and productivity will grind to a halt. It takes time and energy to prevent complications like these and to get team members working well together. You have to explain tasks clearly, coordinate efforts, motivate people, resolve conflicts, give feedback, and develop skills. In short, you have to manage the people with as much discipline as you manage the work. Before investing all that effort, consider whether you even need a team to do the job at hand. We've all been on teams assembled for the wrong reasons, to rubber stamp an already made decision, for example, or to spread out the risk and blame in case a project goes badly. To ensure that your team has a solid reason for being, conduct a straightforward cost-benefit analysis. Will it help you meet your goals and improve your outcomes? Or can you do the work just as well yourself, with greater efficiency and fewer headaches? If you decide the investment is worthwhile, you'll want to create A winning team, of course, not one that crashes and burns or limps along indefinitely. This book will help you do just that. Effective team leadership unfolds in three stages: build up, managing, and closing out. Stage 1. Build your team's infrastructure. Just like a house, a solid team needs a strong foundation. But instead of stones or cement, your materials will be early discussions about goals, roles, rules of conduct, and the metrics you'll use to gauge progress. Once you've enlisted people with the required skills and perspectives, the group must explicitly agree on what it's trying to achieve, how it will get there, and what success will look like. This is how team building really works. It's not about ropes, courses, or whitewater rafting trips. It's about reconciling individual temperaments and work styles to get the most out of each contributor and the team as a whole. You may be thinking, who has time for all these conversations? We have a job to do, and we're already in a pinch to get it done. But agreeing on how you'll do that work beforehand will make it go more quickly and smoothly. You'll have fewer conflicts to navigate, decisions to revisit, and tasks to redo. Because each group has its own quirks, you'll need to build this infrastructure every time you create a new team and every time you lose or add members. Stage 2. Manage your team. If you've ever led a project, you know what it takes to manage tasks. You acknowledge when they're done well and on time. And when something misses the mark, you stipulate changes to get it back on track. Throughout the project, you strive for continuous improvement. The same principles apply to leading a team. When people exhibit useful behavior, such as warning others before a deadline slips, point it out. This motivates them to keep it up and reminds others of what they should do to support team goals. It's just as important to nip negative behavior in the bud. A team member stops participating in meetings, for example, or verbally attacks those who disagree with her. Just as you monitor and tweak tasks to follow a project plan, keep a close eye on how people are doing relative to the goals, roles, and rules you've all agreed on, and talk openly about problems as soon as they crop up. It sounds simple, but most team leaders don't do this. Instead, they let issues go unaddressed until someone explodes in frustration or until everyone mentally checks out, bringing work to a standstill. Stage 3. Close out your team. Say you're almost ready to turn your prototype over to engineering, for example, or to present recommendations to the board of directors. You should be elated, right? The team is so close to achieving its goals. But you've noticed that people are skipping meetings or spending time on other work. What's happening? When the finish line is in sight, team members often lose their focus, drive, and patience. They start thinking about the next project, or obsessing about all their other work that has piled up. You may feel the same impatience to move on. Now, more than ever, it's critical to motivate team members, and yourself, to wrap things up properly and capture best practices to apply next time around. That's what this third stage is about. If you solicit your team's input on what went well and what didn't, you'll manage those problems better in the future. You'll grow as a team leader, and your team members will improve their own skills. We'll cover each of these stages in this guide. Throughout, I provide sample structured conversations and activities developed from my experience of more than 20 years of consulting with teams. I draw on many real examples, some of them disguised, to show how team leaders have applied the advice in a range of situations. You may feel uncomfortable with some of the activities, at least initially, since they deal with the people side of teams, an area where many leaders struggle, especially those who were promoted because of their technical expertise. But give them a try. I've seen them work for new and existing teams, large and small, co-located and virtual, and in just about every organizational setting, including financial services, manufacturing, customer service, technology, nonprofits, and government agencies. They'll help your team to grow, prevent and fix hard problems, and produce the results you're after. Section 1. Build Your Team's Infrastructure. Chapter 1. Pull Together a Winning Team. If you've ever led a team, you've dealt with maddening members. Those who dominate meetings. Slowpokes who analyze every problem from every angle when the schedule is tight. Those who harp on reasons not to support decisions the group made months ago. Quiet folks who say nothing in meetings, but then complain endlessly at the coffee station about decisions that were made in their presence. Those who compete for resident expert status without actually contributing much at all. You may have wondered, do they stay up all night thinking of ways to torment me? What's wrong with them? Why can't they be more like me? That's a common, though a bit melodramatic, response to the challenge of leading a team of diverse individuals. Socially, we all gravitate toward people who are like us, those who understand our humor, enjoy doing the same things we do, and don't get offended when we cancel at the last minute. After all, they do it too. Sameness minimizes conflict and misunderstanding. Yet, to paraphrase U.S. gum maker William Wrigley Jr., when two people think alike on a team, one of them is redundant. Assemble a team of people who are just like you, and you'll undoubtedly experience less frustration. The group will reach decisions more quickly, and members will approach the work in the same way. But lack of diversity has a serious downside. If everyone on the team prefers big-picture thinking, who comes up with the practical steps necessary to realize the group's vision? If everyone likes taking risks, who plans a soft landing before you leap? Who handles the tasks you don't like to do or can't do well? Research repeatedly shows that greater diversity on a team yields more innovation and higher quality work. That's why each individual on your team should bring some unique combination of expertise and skills that will help you produce great work. See Figure 1-1. To achieve the diversity sweet spot you're aiming for, you must first envision the results you want, and then determine what strengths and capabilities you'll need to achieve them. If you're building a business case, for instance, you'll need expertise in data mining and proposal writing. Tap your network for people who are good at those things or ask your colleagues whom they'd recommend. Once you've got someone on board who possesses a critical skill, don't add another team member who excels at the same thing. Remember to address both task-related strengths and people skills when assembling your team. Consider this hypothetical example illustrating the value of diversity on a team. Imagine that your company has experienced a dramatic increase in products returned from customers. If you pull together a team of 6 engineers to analyze the problem, chances are they'll quickly come to one conclusion and make a recommendation consistent with their common backgrounds. It's an engineering issue, and the solution is to rework the design. I know this is a cliche, but it applies here. When everyone on your team is a hammer, then every problem will look like a nail, and every solution will be to pound it. Outcomes will be quick, consistent, and harmonious, but not innovative. Now, suppose you add people from customer service and marketing to your team. Team members will look at the problem from different viewpoints. Maybe it's an engineering problem. Maybe customers don't understand how to use the product correctly. Or maybe they're buying the wrong model for their purposes. That's the good news. A variety of perspectives expands the number of possible solutions. But the team still must work together to come up with a single creative solution. The decision-making takes much longer, and relationships may get strained as members hash out conflicting ideas. So what's the right amount of diversity? John Katzenbach and Douglas Smith define the optimal makeup of a team in their classic Harvard Business Review article, The Discipline of Teams, this way. A small number of people with complementary skills who are committed to a common purpose, set of performance goals, and approach for which they hold themselves mutually accountable. Building on this definition and drawing on my years of experience consulting with teams and leading my own, I've developed the following principles for assembling an effective team. Make it small. The larger the team, the more difficult it is to find meeting times, the longer it takes to make decisions, and the tougher it is to manage information and workflow. So bring together the smallest number of people necessary to provide the skills and perspectives you need. That's usually somewhere between 3 and 7 members. Other contributors who will be needed only occasionally, organizational allies, content experts, and advisors, should not be included as full-fledged members. That just wastes everyone's time. Instead, consult them at specific points and assign one member to serve as a conduit of information back and forth. For example, a finance representative should weigh in as you put together a budget request for a project, but that person obviously shouldn't participate in all the team building and ongoing work that doesn't require financial expertise. If you are assuming leadership of an existing team, you'll need to start by deciding whom to keep and whom to cut loose. If the numbers feel bloated, consider defining a core team of a few essential people and moving others onto a support team that you enlist on an ad hoc basis. This strategy is particularly useful if you have inherited some non-contributors, complainers, or obstructionists. If you can't eliminate them, you can at least marginalize their impact. Incorporate skills and knowledge. List the skills and types of expertise you'll need to tackle the team's responsibilities, not just what's needed to accomplish the work, but also what will facilitate collaboration. Again, use Figure 1-1 to get started. Then identify the fewest number of people who can cover most of those requirements. You can also conduct this inventory to re-evaluate your current team. If certain members aren't contributing much, ideally, you'll remove them. But if you don't have that authority, try giving them support team status, as suggested. Does your team lack key competencies? Add people to fill those gaps, or at least identify advisors you can call on periodically. Include diverse approaches to work. The best teams offer a mix of work styles, people who can carefully address one task at a time, and those who can multitask, folks who excel at contingency planning, and those who nimbly adjust when problems strike, and so on. Here, we're talking about people's natural inclinations, not the skills they've acquired through training or experience. When assembling your team, consider how people differ in their outlooks, priorities, and attitudes about decision-making, change, and risk. Don't drive yourself crazy trying to include every conceivable work style on your team. It's just not possible. But identify people whose wiring differs from your own and who possess characteristics essential for your team's success. If you're leading a team that will drive deep change in the organization, you may want members on both sides of the change spectrum, early adopters to generate creative ideas, and late adopters to anticipate sources of resistance. See Figure 1-2. Though work quality will benefit from a mix of personalities and approaches, relationships may suffer. For example, the big-picture thinkers might regard the detail-oriented people as data geeks crippled by analysis paralysis, and the detail people may dismiss the big-picture folks as unrealistic or people who shoot from the hip. Why would you want both types on your team? Imagine how much work would get done with only big-picture thinkers to execute ideas. Probably very little. They'd generate lots of excitement and creative thought, but the goals would keep changing and expanding, and no one would focus on how exactly to accomplish them. And you wouldn't be any better off with an entire team of detail-oriented colleagues. They'd provide clarity, structure, and solid documentation of progress, but their outcomes would probably resemble what's been done in the past. They wouldn't break new ground. So the differences are worth the potential headaches. We'll talk more about how to handle the conflict, both destructive and beneficial, that is a natural byproduct of diversity in Chapter 11, Resolve Conflicts Constructively. But let's now look at ways to minimize the headaches by anticipating some of the problems members will have. Chapter 2. Get to know one another. Now that you've identified the skills and expertise your project needs and pulled together your team, it's time for your launch meeting. You've made a PowerPoint deck outlining the project, you've provided coffee and donuts, and everyone's sitting around the table expectantly. How do you begin? If you're like most of us, you welcome everyone, introduce yourself, and then ask each person to share his or her name, title, and maybe a little about yourself. But hang on. Don't zip past those introductions. Before you dig into that deck and start explaining and organizing tasks, it's essential to gather some personal data to help the group establish effective goals, roles, and rules of conduct. I'm not suggesting that your team members should share their favorite reality TV shows or fun facts about themselves. Rather, I'm encouraging you to connect with them in a meaningful way so that you and the rest of the group will know what each person needs to do his or her best work. Begin by addressing the fundamental questions they're privately contemplating.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.